Hey guys, welcome to another episode of CirqueCast, and today we're doing things a little differently. We are in New York, New York, and we're here to see Paramour before it closes on April
4th.
Are you sure? And we're here to see Paramour before it closes on
the 16th of April.
April 16th, that's right. So we kind of just wanted to, you know, give our, or say our thoughts before the show, what we're expecting, and then later on after we see the show, we have, or we're seeing the 3 p.m. show
right now. Seeing 3 p.m. first.
What are you expecting, Dario?
I'm expecting over the top and under thought out, to be honest. Like, way underdeveloped, but way over the top.
There are some things, you know, I've seen, like the Western scene, that I'm not excited. We talked about this before.
I'm excited for that.
Yeah, Dar is excited, and he has a surprise. Sort of. And so I was really excited to see Paramour, and when I found out that it was closing, I really, really wanted to come see it, just because, you know.
We have to.
Well, we say it's closing. Cirque du Soleil said they want to move it to either another theater. They're looking for another theater, maybe either outside of the country. Or also maybe touring it. I'm not sure about the touring.
I feel a European tour before an American tour for some strange reason.
But as it's looking right now, we haven't heard anything else, so it's looking like it may just not even happen. So that's why we had to come see the show. But anyways, yeah, we're going to see two shows tonight, and we'll have our thoughts after we see it initially. We're going to head to the theater in just a little bit to see the show, and then we'll have our thoughts after that.
We're coming for you, Doug.
Welcome to the golden age. Tucks and tails, it's all the rage. Brought to life upon a stage with magic. He is the master of captivating scripts.
Life now, I'm sure.
And his dreams still come true.
Then I only have one wish. At the end of all of this, there's you.
Show business.
All right, so we're back. We just finished watching Paramour.
Round one,
that's right. So we went to the 3 p.m. show. And
with Doug.
That's right, with Doug, our friend Doug, and his wife Mary. And I'll start by saying that I surprisingly really, really liked the show. Dario, I guess we'll find out very soon.
It's a 50-50 at this moment. There was some technical difficulties during the first act that made me focus my attention elsewhere, but second act I was really focused and enjoyed what I saw. I just need to go back and relive the first half again.
Let's talk about the theater really quick. You didn't like the Aladdin theater. You thought it was a little
tacky
and old.
It's tacky. There's too much stuff sticking out. There's like stuff on the walls. There's just like purples and blues and greens and blues and purples everywhere. Very, very tacky. I'm not going there to see the theater. I'm going to see the show, but still, it's a little odd. This theater, on the other hand, 180. Clean. Beautiful. Everything has a meaning where it's placed. It's there for a reason. It's not just like, stick it up. It's a nice theater. Very inviting theater.
Definitely looks a lot cleaner than compared to Aladdin. Yeah, so let's get into the show. The show begins, and obviously it opens with the Hollywood Whiz, like on the soundtrack. The curtain goes up.
Exactly.
No, I really, really liked the opening. I thought it was full of energy. It's very flashy. And I love the song.
Good song. Very good song to start the show off, I will agree.
And so here you start seeing, you know, the dancers, they're all dressed in like
tuxedos.
Yeah. Tuxedos and
ballroom dancing kind of like for the women.
And so I thought it was a great opening.
I disagree.
Why?
Because it's a little sloppy and it doesn't have a focus. Which is okay. A lot of shows kind of do that, but this one needs to have that focus. And you're just, I mean, it's like talking to me. It's like I'm all over the place and you can't focus. And it's just a little distracting.
But Cirque is not about focus. You have an act with a lot of things going on around you.
No.
So this is why we say, when you see a Cirque show, you're not necessarily seeing the same thing.
No.
Because you're looking around, you're looking at something that, you know, and it happens with me. Like, you know, La Nuba, still, I still see some things at La Nuba. I've seen it 11 times now, and I still see different things. You know, Kuza, same thing. I've seen it 12, 13 times. There's always something new that I catch. So I think it's a little unfair for you to say that there's so much going on because this is what Cirque is about. There's always, wherever you look, something's going to be happening unless it's meant to not be that way.
True, very true. But usually it has a purpose and it's a well thought out execution, not just like, we'll have it happen because it has to happen. Like, well, there's space that we need to fill, so just have something going on right
now. Well,
this
is an opening number. You have all these dancers. This is supposed to be sort of a show-stopping opening.
Ah, show-stopping opening. That's where you already messed up.
Why is that?
Because a show-stopper is exactly what it means. It's supposed to stop the show. It doesn't start the show. It's like, you hit them with something soft and light, and then you suck them and you don't go, pow, welcome to Paramore. It's too much. And I like over the top, but the opening is, there's over the top, here's where Paramore is. It goes there, dude, and it knows it. It knows it. It knows it's a little cheesy and over the top. So I appreciate that. I just wish it was a little bit more well put together. It's like, it just feels sloppy at first. You're just kind of like, I don't know. I did not enjoy it.
I think I liked the dancing. I like there's tap dancing in there as well.
That was cool.
I think that the what was it? Sort of. It's not a dodge. It's not hand to hand. The acrobatics going on in there. I think that didn't make sense.
It didn't make sense.
Put in there in between the people tap dancing and
there was that little acro tumbling that they would do. Like on that little mat, and then they throw her up. It was just.
But aside from that, I thought the choreography was great. So for me, the opening was good. You, not that you didn't hate it.
Just it didn't capture me like say like the first 20 minutes of a normal Cirque show does. It piqued my interest, but it didn't grab me and make me like sit there and shake and like. Like, here's my soul in front of my face. Look at it. It was just like, okay, I'm watching people act. I'm watching people sing and dance. It wasn't, the believability level for me is hard to buy into it.
So then, it ties in with the story. So the Hollywood Whiz is AJ. Who's the director. At this point, you don't see any of the characters. You have Joey, Indigo, and AJ, who are the three main characters. So you have the director, who's AJ Indigo, she's the singer or the star, and you have Joey, who is supposed to be the songwriter. So this is how AJ gets introduced. And he steps up, he's in the on the stage after the number, and it's just him, and he's telling you a story. From what I understand, there's just been a lot of changes. That is one of the newer changes. Per our friend Doug, who has seen the show several times, so he's actually seen the progress of the show, you know, with the changes.
And they're still happening.
Apparently, they're still happening. So something that he pointed out was, if this is an indication that, you know, they're preparing to maybe take it to another country, maybe this is good.
Why create something if you know it ain't going anywhere? So, and he said it was very themed towards a European market. So,
I mean, makes sense, but we don't know yet. We haven't heard anything. So after that, what I think Ginger, I think it follows the order of the soundtrack. So Ginger Top would be next.
But you know, they're like snippets of the song. It's not like here's the song. It's like little piece of the song, little action, little piece of the song, little action. It was really unique. I like how they did that one.
Ginger Top.
Yeah, it's very
and
cool.
The act for that was the unicycle.
Unicycle with the him like he's carrying a lady, and it was good. It was very sexual.
I liked it. So the scene is, they're sort of like in a bar.
They're in a bar. Half the people are actually acrobatics, and the other half are just drunk. You have to figure out who's who, and that's kind of fun.
It definitely was a fun act. I think the way it. I mean, was there a point to the unicycle? No. I wouldn't say there was. However, the way it was integrated is really cool. It's really nice. I like the chemistry between...
Very good. Very smooth and natural.
Right.
Doesn't feel forced.
And so at this point, I think RJ, the director, was trying to... You know, he's trying to make films and trying to get something else in those films. And he determines he wants... like acts, you know, things like that. So that's how they tied in a little bit of the acts in the show.
To be more extreme and to kind of show he doesn't really care for his actors, he cares for the project. And if they get in harm's way, that's part of the process.
And he hates writers. He doesn't need writers on the set because he...
Because he's the director.
People don't care about the writers. They just care about the movie.
Yeah.
So at this point, after the unicycle, you know, he's looking for a new leading lady. And at the bar, Indigo comes out and she starts singing. She sings at the bar. And so this is where we get introduced to Indigo. And
what was her name?
Indigo.
No, but what was her name?
Like Verna.
Yeah, really funny little joke in there.
Right, so because she's supposed to be like a country girl, southern girl? No, not southern, just country girl.
Just a country girl.
Right, and her name was Verna. And Joey also comes out in this scene, and Joey is the songwriter, and he's playing piano. He's actually playing piano for Indigo when she sings. What was the song?
It's the, please allow me to introduce myself. Right. I'm your woman from Indiana. So she's from Indiana.
Right. And so the song was written by Joey, who was playing the piano at that time. AJ sees Indigo and just falls in love with her voice and her. And, you know, she's like, she's going to be my next star. And so he introduces himself to her, and from there, he's like...
Well, she thinks he's just some scummy old man hitting on her, like...
That's right.
Like, hey, sure, I haven't heard this one before, whatever.
Nice pickup line.
And then so she's like, whatever, I'm leaving. He goes, well, have you heard this one before? I'm AJ Cole. Stops her in her tracks. She knows that name.
She definitely does. And so Joey comes in, and same thing, you know, he thinks like he's just trying to, you know... trying his pickup lines on her, and he knows his name as well because he's supposed to be at this time a known director. And then he proposes to them, you know, he wants to make her a star, and Joey, who, Indigo and Joey were, or Verna, were a team. And so, so not to leave Joey behind and to bring in Indigo, AJ agrees to hire Joey for his music, for him to write music, and then the music will be used in AJ's films, which they never were.
Well, because he never had the intention to actually use the songs. He needed her, and he needed it to be as easy as possible by getting in through him. There is some clever writing here. There really is. I mean, there's moments where I go, okay, like, believable. I get that. I enjoyed those moments of truth.
Right. And so, you know, there's several elements to Paramore, and you have the storyline, you have the acts, and I honestly like the stage, the scenography of everything that's going on and the way they change it. And at first when I was looking at it, I was seeing pictures and videos, and I was confused. I'm like, how does it go from, you know, the Hollywood Whiz set to... And then you have like a Western scene.
Or
the bar, yeah.
So cool how they pulled that bar out and 2 seconds later it's like, they're at a bar.
Well, my point was, like, it just seemed like it was a scene after scene after scene. Then there was totally different, you know, Cleopatra, the bar scene, and then you have the Western scene, and then you have the rooftops, and like, how are they tying all that in? So the way they're doing it is, some of the stuff is, they're AJ's movies, they're AJ's films, and this is how they're filming something for some of his films.
Exactly. Very clever. I'm going to give it to him.
So I like that. I like the way they integrated all that. So then, you know, AJ tells Indigo what he wants, basically his plan for her to be a star. And then eventually, you know, Indigo starts, you know, she's filming all this stuff with AJ, and that makes Joey a little bit jealous, you know, because she's no longer hanging out with Joey. Right?
Yeah.
And so he kind of confronts her, and at this time, I guess, Indigo doesn't really know that Joey is in love with her.
But she doesn't know that she's in love with him either.
Right. So you don't really see this. They're supposed to be... Well, you kind of feel you Joey...
Likes her.
Liking her.
And she's and just her, like, you're my friend. Yeah, he's just, we're partners in music. And then you can kind of tell he's a little put off by it, but it's okay, you know? At least we're together doing something.
So eventually it leads to the Muse. The song, The Muse. She is mine.
Oh.
And that's where we see the film strip. The film strip. You guys might know it from EDs. I really, really, really liked how it was integrated into Paramore. It's a little different. So for those of you who say Paramore is just EDs, Paramore is not EDs, okay?
I'm close.
They may be maybe one or two elements here
props,
and there,
props, sets.
Things like that. But Paramore is far from being EDs, in my opinion, and you agree.
Big time.
So yeah, the film strip is really cool because it's just him seeing himself with Indigo and, you know, kind of professing his love for her, and I really, really liked the way it was used, and I mean the audience really liked it too
because it's fun, it's playful, and it's what Cirque does best. Images that you've never seen. What does a piece of film look like?
We're going
to
really
bring that to life. I mean, there was one part where they were a little out of sync, but for the most part they were almost identical. And that's when that inside of me just starts to rumble and shake, and I'm just like, oh my God.
I do have to say that I really like the dancers in Paramore.
No, the dancing is... Okay, here's typical Cirque dancing.
But because, again...
Because they're not dancers.
They're not dancers.
Dancing in here is like... Holy crap. They didn't cut any corners really with the dancing and like all the like the house troupe people. They all pull the weight. Even the person in the back corner is just killing it. Just killing it.
Now, full disclaimer, I'm not a Broadway person. I'm not a Broadway snob or anything like that. So my view is just as a normal person seeing a show and as a Cirque fan. So for me, the dancing was great. I don't know compared to the other Broadway shows, but that's not the purpose
well,
of this review necessarily.
There was a lot of dancing in Aladdin that was a little hokey. You know, like, didn't feel like that in this. It felt very classy.
Classy.
Very classy. No
Those
hokiness.
Dancers are really good.
Yeah, their timing is perfect. They were all in like really good sync, which makes everything more believable, and the dancers are moving together.
Although you can see when you can see who's a dancer and who is an artist dancing in a certain scene.
Yeah, there's a few that stand out like a sore thumb, but doesn't matter because the audience still loves them. So there's one part, I think this is the next part, is when they're like giving her a screen test. And to do the screen test, they're recapturing famous movie posters, Casablanca, Gone with the Wind, and they're doing it all on stage. It's really cool. Like,
because they're using the EDs effect where you have that camera and you see it projected on the back.
And then they hold a couple bars right here and it looks like the film strip and like...
And then it kind of fades, like you're seeing the live image of what's going on stage.
And then it fades out.
Fades out
and
it's
the actual
poster.
Really clever. Once again, this is what Cirque does best. Images.
And, right. And so you have, they have a blue screen and a yellow screen.
Mm-hmm.
And so that basically they're doing the effects
all on stage, right in front of you. There's a dude like right at the bottom of the stage with the camera shooting everything. It's just, yeah, they really, they, they made it fun. They made that poster part really fun because it's all over the place, but it's has a purpose. It has a point. And it's very quick, and there's a few jokes in there too that, you know, might go over your head if you don't know film. But I caught a few of those jokes and was loving it.
What to do when butterflies keep me up for sleepless nights? A little nervous, I admit, but once I get the hang of it.
So then eventually we get to the point where Joey goes to look for Indigo, and Indigo is at AJ's place, remember? And he's saying, well, I haven't seen you in a while. And she's like, I've been busy with AJ, blah, blah, blah. And that's Serenade Through a Window. Is that the name of the song?
I think it was.
Yeah, and there's a slide. It's Aerial Hoop. Remember in the back, but it was
only for about 45 seconds to a minute.
Yeah, it just feels like, you know what, just go out there, do your thing, and then...
Once again, it's like, well, we have all this space we need to fill. What can we do?
Right.
Ah.
So then, I think after that is... And forget us, for those who have seen it, if we're forgetting it, I mean, it's just...
It's fresh. We just saw it 2 minutes ago.
Right, and so, you know, we... Dara and I were kind of discussing a little bit. We were like, you know what? Let's just save it so they can get our
a real opinion instead of like a reprise. Because right. I reprise a lot.
He does. So, yeah. After that, I think that's when we get the Cleopatra scene,
which is cluttered. Which is
now the way we get it. The way they get into the Cleopatra scene is basically AJ's next film is going to be Cleopatra,
and it's a really cool setup. With the pyramid in the background, and it's a fun setup. It really is.
It starts with the song Cleopatra. I don't necessarily like that song.
It's got a
and
good.
And it's just her singing, and everyone's dressed in this. Their Egyptian.
Yeah,
costume.
She comes out in this wicked headpiece. Just wicked headpiece.
I saw Daria laughing.
Yes.
I think he found it really tacky.
I didn't
find it tacky. I didn't like it. And the problem that I have, and this is where after Cleopatra, and they're still, remember, they're still in this scene, the African twins come out and they do their straps act.
Well, hold on. First, they're wheeled out on a platform and they do a little bit of like,
hand-to-hand.
A little hand-to-hand real quick, just to show, like, you know, we trust each other. And then they go up, and the audience is just breathless the entire time.
So then, yeah, they do their act. You know, the twins, they're great. And everyone knows they're great.
It's the same act.
It's the same act.
A little different. They get really close to the walls, which I like. There's one part where they swing, and they're, like, an inch away from hitting the wall. And I like that element of, like... danger, because when you know that these people are so good, they're never gonna fall. So to see, like, maybe they'll hit a wall. it added that actual element that when you see people 40 foot in the air flying around should have. I've just lost it with them because I know they're the best.
And the audience loved them. You know, they
biggest cheer of the night
for sure.
Biggest cheer at the end.
And I have to say, even before that, I was hearing a lot of oohs and ahs and wows and like. Man, and you know, clapping and all that. The people seem to really like the show, and we'll get into that a little bit later. The problem I had with this scene, with the Cleopatra scene, was it just seemed up until then, I felt like the acts were integrated very well, like within the scene.
The context fit the actual.
And then you get to the straps and. It was just, I didn't understand the...
Well, he says, the director says, I'm going to offer up, like, twins. She goes, what is a twin supposed to do? And it's like, well, twins have, like, a magic power or something. And then, off they go.
Yeah, I didn't get it. I mean, I...
Didn't
even,
get it.
Even with you telling me that I must have missed it, I did not understand.
Yeah.
No, I'm not saying anything about the act. I'm saying the context of
Why am I watching
and,
it?
Right, and why is that? Why there's a strap act?
At least our costumes matched the theme. I just wish that the content was matching too. Like, okay, now I have a reason to see them floating around.
So Cleopatra is the song where the scene starts, and then for the twins' act is it's the song Egyptian Gift.
Egyptian Gift.
And I like that song.
Great song.
I just don't know how it fits in that scene.
Because it doesn't. Because it doesn't.
Now, we're getting to the part that I always talk about when I talk about Paramore. And I just cringe when I think about it and I see it. And this is the Western scene. The infamous Western scene. And
the amazing Western scene.
And I have to say that I agree with Dario. I was proven wrong. The way it transitions to the Western scene is basically he had, what was the name of the film he did?
I forget. Jane, but yeah, it was a Western.
Basically, AJ is saying, you know, he made a film.
And they're like, well, how can you do that? How can you turn a pyramid into...
No, he was saying, why don't you show it? And he's like, well, how are we going to change the set? And how are we going to change the costume? Boom, and so, yeah, one thing after another, they all take off their Cleopatra scene costume, and then they're all in the Western scene. And
within 5 seconds.
And it was, I mean, I'm like, oh, and then remember I was saying, oh, here we go. Oh, here we go.
He goes, yeah, he looks at me and kind of is like, here it is. And dude,
it was fun. It was awesome. And the act here is the teeter board act.
Who the heck complains about a teeter board act? These are some of the most talented people working in Cirque today. Wow. Did they pull a couple tricks on me that I didn't see coming?
It was so much fun. So much fun.
There was a few moments where I'm like, yep, this is Cirque.
This is Cirque.
And I don't get why people complain about that scene so much because
it feels, we think about it. You have a show about a movie star, mm-hmm, and then suddenly you have a Western scene.
Well, Westerns are actually some of the biggest movies ever.
Right, but it's not, this is not what this show is about.
No, the show is about just movies in general.
I know, so they can go anywhere. But just think about it. You start with the Hollywood Whiz, and we talk about the dancers, and mm-hmm, they're in tuxedos, and it's supposed to be classy, right? Mm-hmm. And then you have people in boots.
I know. And then Cleo,
long dresses, and but it was great. I really...
These are just tiny nitpicks that I feel like don't really take away from the show, but would just make it that much better if they figured them out. Just my opinion.
But yes,
the Western scene is great. Then the music, it helps.
Catchy.
It helps you move. I look to my left, smiles. I look to my right, smiles. I can't complain. Everyone was happy.
So after the scene, I'm trying to remember how it goes into intermission.
I forget what the intermission song is, but I know what the intermission song
now
coming back is.
So remember, this is where AJ gets mad. Because doesn't Joey come in?
Oh, he comes in and he just accidentally proposes to...
No, this is before that.
Okay, what?
Does he propose?
Yeah, he just accidentally says, well, what if you marry me?
That's right.
And then...
Oh, yeah, so anyways, AJ gets mad because of the interaction between Indigo and Joey, isn't it?
Joey.
Remember, and he starts taking it out on the people who are doing the people from the Western scene, which is the teeterboard artist. And so this is where the act ends, sort of, and then AJ gets mad and he's instructing them, you have to do 2-3 flips or whatever, remember?
Mm-hmm.
And so then, and this is really cool because
really
the
cool
teeterboard artists are actually doing what AJ is telling them, and these
Cowboy,
are like the cool,
get
the
up
cool
there.
Tricks. Yeah.
Big guy, get up there!
And so he's just going crazy, and he's like, everyone dance, you know? And I think after that, he's like, impossible. Like saying, oh, you're saying this was impossible? And he's just mad, and I think the lights go down, and that's where...
Yeah, he's like just fed up with everything, and it's like a explosion in his head, and then everything comes to a standstill. And then the lights come on, and I'm sitting there left like...
And this is intermission.
And so, this is intermission.
And still, you know, the whole... Western scene.
So the Western, yeah, it fizzles out with the Western scene, but it all fits where it needs to. It doesn't take away from anything. Then the big blackout, you're kind of left wondering where, well, how does it, we go into this?
So after intermission, it starts, you don't remember how it starts?
I do. I was just giving you a setup.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
The dream. It starts with the dream. So RJ's sitting there.
AJ.
Why do I keep saying
RJ? Because
you're
in love with someone named RJ.
So oh, AJ. RJ Owens. That's right. Our friend RJ
so
Owens.
AJ's sitting in a chair reading a newspaper. Out comes, from the back, comes a guy with rings, three white rings on his head. And then two fall off and one stays there. And then he goes and stands over AJ and starts to, I don't know, like control him, put him in a trance. And he basically like falls asleep in the chair. And this is when my heart is actually full of joy and love and just everything Cirque is. The music is there. The singing is there.
The Dream is my favorite track from the soundtrack. And I think
the visuals, this juggler does something that no other juggler's ever done. And that's keep a very steady pace. He's not trying to show you what he can do. He's trying to show you how beautiful it can be. And he does these maneuvers that I've never seen. I mean, I've seen juggling. I have never seen the way he would move his body.
It's very smooth.
Manipulate the rings. He did drop once, but no, his face didn't drop. He was just like, it didn't affect him at all.
And so for the most part, it's sort of it's juggling, but like also manipulation.
It's manipulation with an umbrella.
He brings out an umbrella.
Three rings.
And it's really cool. Like, when the umbrella comes out, he's juggling the rings and the umbrella at the same time.
And I mean, like the weight difference. So he's like flipping and then it's, you think he's going to miss it. He catches it at the last moment.
And why an umbrella? Well, in this scene also, in the dream, it starts raining.
It starts raining.
And so,
and you hear
RJ
thunder.
Is, RJ, crap. AJ. AJ.
Man crush.
No. AJ is dreaming that Indigo and Joey are together. It's raining, and so the juggler gives an umbrella to the two of them, and they're kind of just sitting there in the rain, in the bench. And then he's juggling and
some beautiful, slow, well thought out moves that just visually on my eyes, on my ears, it did what it needed to do. Really great way to open the show. Why couldn't they start the show like that? I don't know, but good way to come back for the second half. Really strong. Really strong.
I don't think it's energetic enough to be an opener.
No, it's not, but that's what I mean, though. At least it was focused, and it had a point. Very, is it good?
But don't you think it's a great way to come back from the intermission?
My God, it was the best. If they would have put the zombie scene, if they would have switched those two, yeah, I probably wouldn't have liked it so much. But because you're coming off of this dude's, and then you're opening with him sitting there, it was good. It was good.
So he mentioned zombies. Zombies is the next act after the juggler.
Second favorite act of the show for me.
To me, it's a little like it made me think of Thriller.
Made me think of, you know, zombies. It had like a little Zarkana darkness to it, and the way the singing was, and the way that they were moving. It was gorgeous to my eyes. They wear these masks with these stupid little things and the stupid hair.
What was the act? You remember the act?
Gorgeous. It's like stripper poles?
It's just poles. Not stripper poles. They have three poles.
They have three poles sizes. With light. It's like a light. Like a light you'd see in like a park. Like
oh,
a
that's
old
right. They're supposed to be like
lanterns.
Lanterns.
And there's three different sizes. And they're fast. These dudes are like, one's here, and then he slides down, he jumps over him, and there's like a lot of in and out, back and forth, and twisting. I really enjoyed that scene a lot. Definitely my second favorite after the Western scene.
And so the song is Revenge Fantasy, right?
Which fits perfect. It's very dark.
And so AJ wakes up from his dream.
Yeah, he wakes up, and he's just kind of confused.
Right, because remember, up to this point, everything was an actual dream.
Was a dream.
So at this, after, you know, Indigo comes out, and then Joey comes out as well, and this is the love triangle?
Yes.
Now, for love triangle, all we saw was them singing.
One over here, one center stage.
Kind of going back and forth. Yeah. There was no act, and we were told that there was supposed to be an act.
Which, I can see it not needing to be there, but I can definitely see using all that space.
It's just sitting there empty. I just thought it was like, it's just about them three. So I'm like, okay, I didn't even think there was supposed to be an act.
I didn't either.
Maybe you did. But then we were told that we were leaving that the act was out.
I was just wondering how come they decided to fill all this other space when it didn't matter.
Very
but
true.
Why is
because
that space still empty? There's always something somewhere.
So here we get this empty space.
Now after Love Triangle, so basically Indigo has to choose between Joey or AJ. Remember, because AJ says, you're not a good actress, you need to be with me.
I'm the one who, you know,
who made you.
Well, no, basically he said, you're not a good actress unless I'm behind the lens. I made you, you know, you're okay, but with me you could be great. So she
Indigo's like,
she
AJ, you're right, you're the reason why I'm the way I am. And he chooses AJ. They both leave. Oh, and so at this point, throughout the show, you hear Joey complaining that AJ hasn't used any of his songs.
Yeah.
And AJ keeps saying, well, you haven't written a good song. So get to work. And this is where he says, like, pretty much, get to work. Write me a good song. They both leave. And this is writer's block, right?
Yes.
And Richard has said he doesn't really like the song because it's very whiny.
It is.
But I really like this song. And, you know, it's Joey with his guitar.
Very emotional. He's actually playing. You can hear the strings. And he's just emoting, man. He's really feeling that character. Like, it is ridiculous how good that actor is.
And what comes out? What act happens during?
Hold on.
You liked it?
Remember. Was it the wheel?
Sir Wheel.
Okay. So here we go. Sir Wheel. Been done. You've seen it. What can you do? Not much. I don't know what this guy did, but he did something that made it fun again. Like, he never stopped. He was never static. Sometimes you'll see him stop and then reset. This guy just went and went, and then he does, you know, the, I'm gonna fall down. Oh no, I'm back up. So dramatic. I mean, he was like an inch from the ground and then, blah, 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 I'm back. Love
that. How did he go?
Blah, 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 I'm back. Absolutely one of the most unique moments.
But and you know, throughout the, I guess in between the acts and, you know, the songs, you do have dialogue, you do have sort of like funny moments and jokes and things like that.
There, so
it's not a straight up musical. Like, there's dialogue.
It's
because, again, there's the storyline.
Well, I mean, it's a play, it's a musical, it's a Cirque show, it's everything. It's a hybrid of just fun stuff that doesn't take itself too serious, which, you know, doesn't really help their cause. All three hearts are in a tangle and they're caught up in a love triangle. A little harder, guys, please.
All right,
a little harder.
So after Writer's Block, it's the song Everything, the Lover's Theme. Remember, Joey is, he's on the piano, and he doesn't have the lyrics yet. He just has the music.
Mm-hmm.
So Indigo comes in, and she's like, oh, you're still here? And he's like, I was just leaving. He's still mad because
she chose AJ.
And so she's like, take a look at this. And, you know, he's like, no, whatever. And she finally convinces him, and he starts playing the piano, and he's playing Everything, the Lover's Theme, and she starts singing. And then eventually she confesses to him.
This works for the characters, but it also works for us, don't you think?
He's like, well, you chose AJ. And she's like, it is you who are, basically she's saying, you're the person that I love. And then she's like, well, and he's like, well, why'd you say that to AJ? And she's like, well, I was proving my point that I am a good actress.
And then big laugh, and then they embrace, and it's a good moment. It's a really good moment.
There's a bigger moment in this scene.
There is a bigger moment, but there's a connection between them, how they're facing each other, and they're just looking at each other. That is very believable.
Now, on stage, all you see is the piano. Them two, and then sort of like in the background, it's just supposed to be, I guess, like a wall and two lamps. Now you know what I'm talking about, right?
The unexpected.
So then suddenly the lamps come on,
So at first you just see two lamps, and
the lights are off. The lamp.
But you know what they are. It's a lamp. That's right, just a lamp. There's a chair. There's a lamp. And then the background opens, and you see a few more. And you go, okay. And then
the lampshades start flying.
And then I'm thinking, okay, all right, this is going to be a little weird. Oh, contraire, mon frère. Beautiful. Choreographed. Like, there wasn't even, like, they were almost more in sync than some of the actors were tonight. I mean, it was.
Well, it's the technology behind it, so.
No, there's someone back there.
Right, but it's all technology, so they're programmed. But yes, it was beautiful, beautiful. You have these
unexpected. And I mean, there's this big black sheet in the back with like diamonds on it, and these things are floating. There's red ones and blue ones and green ones and yellow ones. They start doing like patterns, and they start like going. Oh.
Now, so, and you guys might have seen this already. You remember Spark, that video, and I guess that's where the idea came from.
Because they're dancing around with them, kind of, and they're acknowledging the presence of them.
And, and basically they're like just going around the two of them.
There's one part where it dips.
Oh, yeah, and it kind of go like this. So it was really good, and the audience, again, really loved it. It was unexpected. And
I mean, when they come up, you hear everyone go.
Even Dario.
Even me, because
we didn't know that. We had forgot. I had forgotten.
This was in, I had forgotten.
I knew it was in there, and I had forgotten. Totally forgotten.
We locked eyes like, dude! And then I just got as close to the rail as I could.
So that was one of my favorite moments from the show.
And it lasts about 3 minutes?
It was only two to three minutes. From when everything to the end. Yeah.
So. Oh, and how it ends is gorgeous. Because some of them fly away, and then one just kind of floats there. And then it just like,
goes to the back.
And then it like, slowly fades out. They like, it's really, so second half of this show, great.
I do agree that the second half felt more
thought out.
Because they're talking more about the storyline. The first act is more
setup.
About the setup and the
who
you have
are
all
we?
The different scenes and
why are we here? Or what are we doing?
But I actually like the first half as well.
It's good. It is good. But the second half is, in my opinion, the stronger act of the show, which doesn't really, in my experience, the second act really is never the stronger act. There's a few shows that there are. This is one of them.
After that, basically, you have a few, you know, there's dialogue, and AJ says, our last film, because Indigo plans on marrying Joey after she films her, she had a contract for three films with AJ. So after her last film, she was going to tell AJ, I'm done.
Well, she was playing possum.
Right.
Thinking like, yeah, this is it.
So
we're going to get married.
She's still engaged to AJ at this time, actually. And so then she finds out that, well, the filming of the last movie is going to be in New York. She had no idea about. And then AJ says, after we're done filming, we're just going to straight to City Hall and get married. And she's obviously, like, she had no idea. And that's not, she's not planning on doing that.
I wish she would have kind of told me that was going to happen. He's like, no.
And then he says, and I announced it to all the newspapers. And
then a really cool little moment happens in the show with,
there's like, he's giving like a press conference.
It's fun. And
you see projections with like newspapers from like,
you hear all
different newspapers.
Clicking. And
you have some, like the reporters, you know, they're asking him like questions. And then,
oh yeah, there's this one guy, you know, like the comic relief guy. He pops up every once in a while. That's a really good scene of his right there where he's asking some questions.
Right.
He's got a nice moment to shine in that part.
And one of the reporters asks, well, what about him and the song, her and the songwriter? And he's like, what do you mean?
What? He loses his shit. He gets really mad.
And the reporter says, well, there have been rumors. And he's so mad. He's like, I'm going to prove to you right now that she's going to marry me. And so then they all go looking for Indigo. And at this time, at this point, Indigo is planning on running away with Joey because she doesn't want to get married.
And everyone knows that they're not good. So all the supporting characters are helping her escape this guy. Like, they're dressing her up in
like
drag
Ramon.
And stuff.
Yeah, Ramon.
They're like, they're doing some really cool stuff, you know, because it just doesn't work. They're not right together.
So then,
and he doesn't care. He knows it, but he kind of has to be this controlling director, dictator type of deal.
It's kind of like you liked him at the beginning, and then towards the end you're like, maybe he's not that great.
Yeah.
Of a person. Now, I'm not talking about the character, because he's really good.
The actor is, he commands that stage Kushner, from the second.
Right? That's his name, Kushner?
I don't really know his name. I just know he's got a face and a voice that belongs on stage.
Jeremy Kushner, I think.
Guy killed it. Killed it. There was never a moment where I felt like I'm looking at an actor. I felt like that's what's happening. That's just happening with him. He was good.
So then AJ realizes that, you know, they run away. So then he gets his
goons.
Yeah. To follow them. To find them, pretty much. So they're running. They're in the streets of New York. At this time, I guess they're already in New York.
Yeah, they were like
running through New York, and all you see is basically a projection, and it's a video. And
of you see like a swooping bird eye view of like the tops of buildings.
And then you see Indigo running, and they're going through doors, going up to building. It was a little long.
And then finally she pops out in real life and sticks her head out the wall, and then shuts it. In.
And then eventually the because they have the curtain down at this, this time, and then it opens up and you see the rooftop.
They start pushing in the rooftop scene, which, as a set piece goes, is spectacular. I was just in awe of how it looked. And see, we know that there's a trampoline there because we know. Some people didn't. So when he took his first fall and bounced up, people lost their shit. They really did. It's like, okay. I wasn't expecting that. Here we go. And then it goes on for
a little too long.
They think so. I think it's perfect because it's telling a story.
What I did like is that this fit in a lot better than all the other acts. Because
they're running.
They're running and they end up escaping, in the rooftop of New York.
Which is a very visual.
And the goons are following them. And so they're the ones who are performing all the...
Yeah, there's a lot of like, I'm going to come get you. And then he jumps and then, or he falls down and runs over him like a bridge. There's a lot of funny moments in there. And there's a lot of oh shit moments in there. Dude jumps from about 20 feet and grabs a pole. Like, what was that?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Like a 15-foot jump from 20 feet in the air, and he lands on the pole. And you're just like, what just happened? Really cool.
And
at the very end, something that I never thought would happen happens. There's, you know, here's the top part, here's the trampoline part, here's the other top part. Well, at the very top over here, there's a bar. The guy starts swinging on it. Now, he's got to be 25 feet in the air. Swinging, swinging, swinging. And he flies up. Does a couple twists and then hits the thing. It's just...
And it's supposed to be, I guess, him, like, falling or I guess he died.
He died.
He died and...
But it doesn't matter because it leads to this...
Right, and that was the end of the
act. It leads to... Well...
Sort of.
So he gets there and AJ's like, you know, come down, dude. What's his name? Like...
Yeah, so So you see Joey and Indigo, they're out. They're like
they've
by the pole.
The
they're by the pole. And so, yeah, so they're gone. The goons are gone. AJ's down.
On the floor.
I guess supposed to be down on the ground. Or
on the street. Yeah, he's on the street.
On the street. And they're still on the rooftop. And AJ's calling for her. She's like, you need basically come back to me. You're mine. And she's like, no, I'm done with my three films. And he's like... You didn't see the fine print. I
can
much
option
own you
for three more.
Right, exactly. And at this point, the reporters come out and they start taking pictures of her and Joey. And it's kind of like, you know, she's startled and she starts falling.
Yeah, she goes like no,
and she starts falling.
And she literally is leaning like 40 degree angle back.
And the curtain comes down. And all you see is AJ. And he's just, remember, he's thinking.
And now he's thinking to himself.
Basically he's saying, well,
what if the piano boy, I see the piano boy, what if he didn't hold on to her? What if she fell? And then here comes a really beautiful scene where they're lowering her really slow.
And it's like slow motion and she's like falling.
And she's doing all this. And it's actually Ruby up there. That's really her being, you know, brought down from the grid. But she didn't fall. That was just what if, and he was thinking to himself, like, you know, I can't lose her. Even if, like, we can't be together, she's such, like, she's just amazing.
Yeah, so AJ is, like, basically thinking out loud.
If she dies, I'm done.
But then he says something along the lines of him falling, basically not falling in love, that not that falling in love is wrong. It's just falling in love with the person you think you should be in love with. Yeah. Something like that. So then he realizes, I don't love her.
And he does something that no one expected.
And he just says, you know what? You're pretty much are free.
He goes,
go be with your...
I forget how it happens. It was actually quite genius. There was this one little moment of like, I'm a good person, and I see that you guys will be happy together. I'm going to go off and do me no matter what, but I don't want to ruin...
So when Ruby's falling down, Joey catches her.
He catches her. And it's very visually stunning. It really is. The lights in the background.
It's really nice.
You know, it's one of those moments where I get a little like, okay, this is good.
And this is actually how it ends. They both come, remember, to the front, and then the reprise of the Lover's theme, which is how the soundtrack ends.
Which was, yeah, it was a little underwhelming how they just, it's like, I'm an evil director. Oh, I'm good. Go have a happy life. Bye. Thanks for coming. Thanks for coming. Cha, 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 cha.
So after that, yeah, the lights go down, I think.
Very
abruptly. It starts again, and it's Real Love, which yeah. I like that track.
Thanks for the
And it's pretty, honor. Yeah, it's pretty much the curtain call.
Beautiful. Well done. Everyone comes out, take their bows. You know, everyone is about the same. And then the twins come out and the whole place erupts. Like Elvis is back from the dead erupts. Like they lose their shit. I don't get it.
People just love it.
And these are people who probably have not seen it before. And granted, the very first time I saw their act, I died. But I've seen it multiple times in multiple variations by them and by other people doing it like them, and they're good.
So I really, really, really enjoyed the show. One of the things that I said to you was it's definitely entertaining. I like the storyline. I mean, it's not a genius storyline, but it's simple.
It's the thing that makes the only thing that brings the show down for me is its stockiness. It's very stock. It's like the most generic type of like thing that could happen. It's very stocky through the whole thing, you know, but it's okay.
It made it work.
It made it work. But there were just a few moments where I'm like, okay, a little bit, like 5 more minutes to flesh that out.
Now, for a Cirque fan, obviously the show is closing. Do you think that... Do you recommend this show for people to see it before it closes here?
If you're in the casual hardcore group, sure. If you're in the, I don't care where they are, I don't care how much money it's going to cost me, I'm going to go see it. I don't know. I don't think the really, really hardcore people are going to enjoy it as much as the casual goer. Because we know what they can do. It is still enjoyable to us because we are hardcore.
That being said, remember we said... We were talking, and one of the things we don't understand is how people say, this show is not good, or I don't like this show, and they haven't
seen. They're just going off of a YouTube clip, or they're going off of what their friend posted about it. We need to see it actually for ourselves. I need to smell it.
And obviously, you know, some people may not like this. The people who have seen it may not like it.
Well, a lot of fans don't like it.
But this is our opinion, based on what we saw and how we feel. And
this is just the first viewing. We're going to see it again, so it can really set in.
And, you know, when I first saw Lucia, it was a little confusing to me. When I saw it the second
time. When I saw Charuk, remember when we left the theater the first time? I was like,
what was that?
What was that? And then we saw it the next day, and I was like, what was that?
Top five now.
This will never be a top five. This might be a top 20. If it lasts longer than, you know, the 2 months that they have left on their contract.
Which we don't know. But
I mean, I could... Okay. It is not a Barriott show. It's a...
How about this? What do you give it out of 10?
I'm going to have to just say a 6. Because it didn't suck. It didn't suck. There was nothing about it that sucks. Yes, it may not be your taste. I don't like it. But it doesn't suck. It's not dumb. It's... different. And there's a big difference between
it is
dumb
different.
And different.
That's a good way to describe it. Not different like Zarkana. Zarkana's weirdly.
Well, Zarkana tells you in the title, like, you know, Zarkana, bizarre, you know, like crazy.
I think it has some clever moments in the way that they're mixing it with with the storyline.
There was one moment of the show that we forgot to talk about that I have to bring up. It happens at the very beginning. AJ's talking about, you know, I was a huge film director and I made a couple bombs. But I know my next film is going to be amazing. I'm just looking for the right star. And he does this, there's this, you know, projection behind him. And he's like showing you how directors
are. He's saying what the kind of stuff he does.
Yeah, and how he's magic. So he pulls up his thing, but there's nothing in his hand. But behind him, it's one of those cones. And you're like, okay, this is pretty cool. But then he does this one part where he's like, I'm looking for the girl. And he puts his hand out.
And you see the silhouette.
And you see it, but she's like this big. And he takes her and he puts her on the floor. And then she like becomes it and then steps out, and it is fucking mind-blowing.
So you like that?
I love that
part.
You
didn't.
No, because he's doing this and you're like, oh, okay, cool, projection, yeah. But they did it right. They did it so right. Unlike what Love is doing with their projections, they did it wrong. I mean, it's still cool to see it, but they're not using it right. When he took her and she was in his hand and he put her down, I was in tears almost, because that's what Cirque does. They take things that you just don't expect to have. I mean, of course I know someone's going to juggle because it's a Cirque show, but I didn't know they're going to juggle really slow and precise. Oh! So I give it a 6. If you're a hardcore Cirque fan, you might want to see it just to see it. That's the beauty about Cirque, is it touches everyone different. What I see and like, you may hate. That's the beauty of Cirque. You have to see it for yourself. So I give it a 6, but I give it a yes. Go see it. Go see it. Show them that we like when they do something different. Because if, you know, the fans aren't behind it, they're never going to do it again. And I like that they're doing something different. Go see it.
For me, it's a 7.5.
7.5?
Almost an 8.
Whoa. Back up.
Because
I
have to take into... What do you mean? You think it's too high or too low?
That's way too high. A 7.5?
Because I enjoyed it.
Why did you enjoy it? What was so... What made... Because Kuzo to you was like a 12. If this was a 7.5, how?
Because I just liked... I like the music.
It grows on you.
It definitely grows on you. I think what it is like I came with the... thinking that I was not going to enjoy it as much.
Which was a mistake. Don't come into this.
I think that I was going to completely hate the Western scene.
I know a lot of people
it's a Western
steered us really wrong on that.
I think there were some cool moments in the show. Was there an act that I didn't... This is the thing. Was there an act that I didn't like? I think maybe the only one for me would be like the zombies thing. Like,
really? Over the unicycle?
Oh, I like the unicycle.
Oh my god,
you
the
said
unicycle.
You liked it.
I said I like the sexual tension. I didn't say I like the act.
I like the setup of it.
I've just never been a fan of the unicycle.
It's almost impossible for you to like anything, an act that you're not a fan of.
Exactly. Well, it's almost impossible, but if it's done right, I mean, how many times have I seen a guy in a little...
Okay, so you may not like a certain act, but did you hate any acts from the show?
Okay, There's a few examples of outstaying your welcome, but never, not bad acts, just a little too long. See, this is why there's two people, because he thinks one way and I think another.
So yeah, for our final thoughts, maybe you should go see it and form your own opinion. If not, then, you know, just... I guess you'll keep forming an opinion based on
other people's opinions.
Or the videos that you've seen. And not that you're wrong. No one is wrong.
Yeah.
There's no... I mean, this is very subjective. So...
Surprisingly enough, these are our thoughts.
Right. And with that, I guess we'll stop here because we're about to go see the next show at 8 p.m. And, yeah. So, if you guys see Paramore, let us know. Or if you've seen Paramore... Let us know what you think, if you really do like the show or if you do not, and why. So with that, we will see you on the next episode. Hey guys, welcome to another.
Okay, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Ready?
You don't have to be like behind. You can be like right next to me.
No, come.
As long as I can sit here and look sexy.
I want to make sure that you're in focus. You are, right?
I am.
Okay. Ready?
Serious. Light. Camera.
Action.